Good morning, Highland.
Good morning.
And Happy New Year. Thank you all so much for gathering today. It's so good to see all of you. I hope everyone is well rested after Christmas and kind of having a peaceful time. We're going to begin our service of worship by standing and singing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Let's sing together.
Good morning. Hope everyone had a wonderful Christmas season. And remember the reason we celebrate the season. I certainly stressed it with my family. The announcements this morning, tomorrow afternoon, these beautiful decorations need to come down. And at about 2 p.m. tomorrow afternoon, they're asking for people who can come and help them retrieve the decorations and stow them. Local mission opportunities, the volunteers needed to pick up groceries. We volunteer with Community of Hope, the food pantry, and the grocery store on Timber Drive and 50 provides us some groceries, and we need somebody to pick that up between 12 and 1 on a continuing basis. Mark your calendar for the 2024 mission trip. It's scheduled for July the 24th to the 20th. Details to come later. And the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, we're two-thirds of the way to that goal, but we will receive those offerings even after Christmas, so if you want to give to Lottie Moon, please do then. Please join me in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, during this most blessed season, we thank you for your son who you gave to us. We thank you for the leadership of this church. We thank you for a pastor who preaches truth and stays in the scripture, dear Lord. We thank you for a staff that is dedicated. We thank you for volunteers who are always giving their time and energy to further your kingdom. Now bless this church, bless this community, bless us throughout this new year. These things we ask in thy holy name. Amen.
We were weak, without hope, without life, till from heaven.
Thank you.
all about you.
All
bye.
Let's bow in a word of prayer. Father, thank you for seeing us through to the end of this year. For many, it's been a very difficult year. For others, it's been a marvelous year. And honestly, most of us have had both, good and bad, throughout the year. And we thank you that you are God and we are not, and that you are sovereign over all things. And so we come today to gather and worship on this, the last day of 2023, as we look forward to a bright and blessed 2024. Help us to walk closely with you, to give sacrificially, not only of our tithes and offerings, which we have just done today and will throughout the year, but help us to give sacrificially of our lives and our time to those around us, those in need. Father, I pray that you would bless the tithes and offerings. And I pray, oh God, that you would bless those who need your special touch today. And I think particularly of Miss Annie Lee Bagwell, who has been in the hospital. Hopefully will go home today. And Miss Jewel Mangum, who also was in the hospital earlier this month and is at home still recovering. We pray your blessings on them both. And Lord, today we pray your blessings on Royal and Jewel as well as they celebrate 74 years of marriage. What an example to all of us. Thank you for this time to gather and to worship. We pray that you would open our hearts and minds as you open, as we open your word. Help us to understand more than even what is said. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I think I've asked this before, but is anybody here afraid of butterflies? Didn't think so. There is a word for that, and I looked it up one time and had forgotten it, but our daughter is actually afraid of butterflies. Because there is one butterfly in the world that I'm aware of, maybe two, but at least one in Indonesia that was poisonous. And it lived as far away from us to San Antonio as we did from it, but my son told my daughter, his little sister, that there was a poisonous butterfly, and she has been panicked ever since. Can you imagine that? But that's not really what I'm talking about. I want to talk about butterflies because butterflies and moths are a very unique creation of God, are they not? They do something, and I don't know all the scientific terms for it, but they do something called metamorphosis. You've heard that fancy name. They change forms. They morph from one form to another, do they not? They go through this process of being this ugly creature to being this beautiful creature. And they have to spend a certain amount of time in the cocoon. All I could think of was womb, and it knew it wasn't right. Should have written more of my intro out. Is they spend that time in that cocoon, and if you help them out, what happens? It doesn't work. Right, they die. So we are a lot like a butterfly, a worm, a caterpillar that needs to change, transform into something different than we are. And I think we can see some ways that God will help us to do that through our scripture today. We need to morph from Frank White, who lives in the world, to Frank White, who walks in God's will and lives by the power of the Spirit. If you will, turn to Mark chapter 9. We're going to pick back up where we left off. I kind of have to, as Easter will be here before we know it. And I do want to get to resurrection by Easter Sunday morning, which is March 31st. So we will get there. I will take big chunks like today, 29 verses. And we are going to go through this. And just keep that up there for a while. Is it Tyler? Yep, Tyler, just keep that up there for a while. Let me give you some context, okay? Because we've talked about a lot of things from the middle of November until now. And I've had two wonderful folks preach in my behalf there around Thanksgiving, and then we had these wonderful services over Christmas time. Thanks again, Shelley, for leading us and leading the choir. Thank you on the wonderful cantata. My brother's been sending it to all our family. You need to take time and listen to this. It is so cool to see your own brother sending it out. They listen to it, and I know at least one cousin has listened to it as well, and both are very appreciative. And then Christmas Eve. Did y'all make it to Christmas Eve? Wasn't it wonderful? It was just an amazing service and a wonderful, blessed time. But we're back in Mark now, and we're in chapter 9. Let me give you a little context. If you remember at all, Peter has just confessed Jesus as the Christ. In Matthew, he actually says the Son of God. Then Jesus goes on to tell his disciples, said, hey, that's good, but this Son of God, this Messiah, I'm going to have to suffer. I'm going to get beaten. I'm going to get crucified on a cross. But on the third day, I will be raised from the dead. And Peter goes, why? You're supposed to be the Messiah, the one who comes and saves us. Of course, he was thinking differently, and Jesus took him aside and had to rebuke him. And Peter thought he knew better than Jesus, but Jesus had to straighten him out. You're thinking about what you want, and I'm thinking about what God wants. How do we know that? We spend time with God the Father. Even the Son had to do that. We'll see that in just a minute. So Jesus straightened Peter out from the human desires to God's will. Without the suffering and death, Jesus could not have accomplished God's will. And then Jesus says, you got to take up your own cross and follow me. And if you're ashamed of me, if you're ashamed of what I have to go through and what you'll have to go through, then I'll be ashamed of you later in heaven. That's not a good thing, by the way. So Jesus had to straighten him out, and he needs to remind us too that it's not what we want or what we wish and will, but what God wants. That's important. And then Jesus closes out that statement. I don't know why whoever put the numbering system in here did it this way, but Jesus closes out this section with chapter 9, verse 1. He said to them, Jesus said to the disciples, truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death. Just keep it right there. Because I told you back in mid-November that I would explain this as best I can. What does it mean that some standing here will not taste death? Well, has the kingdom of God come? Not fully. Not fully, for sure. It has not come as was expected, as the Jews expected, as Jesus had told and promised. If you read through all the Gospels, we'll get to some of that in a few more chapters. But maybe there was a glimmer of it. I was talking with someone just before service, and I said, theologians have a debate about that particular issue. And in reality, theologians have a debate about this particular issue too. And they come down all over the place. Essentially, the full consummation of the kingdom of God with power is when Jesus returns. Period. But there were glimpses of the kingdom of God. And we'll read about one. Three of them go up on the mountain with Jesus, and guess what happens? They see the glory of God. They hear God's voice. They see Moses and Elijah. They saw something definitely very unearthly on that mount of, I'm going to start trying to say transformation, because that's what the Greek actually says. They saw something very unusual in the resurrection of Jesus. Was that not the power of God raising Jesus from the dead, resurrecting him? And then they were standing there in Jerusalem watching him go up in the sky. Is that not a glimpse of God's power and his kingdom? And then, probably 10 days later, It's hard to count all those days, but roughly Jesus was with his disciples for 40 days. And then 10 days later on Pentecost, what happened? Fire, tongues of fire on their head. The Holy Spirit came down. Was that not the power and the almighty glory of God? But not completely. Other scholars actually add this one, and I hadn't thought about it this way. The kingdom of God actually did spread rapidly across the Roman Empire in the next 30 to 50 years. The kingdom of God and the power of God was manifest in all kinds of ways. Read through Acts and you'll see all of the disciples healing and even raising from the dead occasionally. There was a place where even the shadow could pass by people and heal them. Even handkerchiefs could come and touch the apostle and be taken back to people and heal them. Is that not the power of God? The majesty of God and the glory of God in some miraculous ways. I think you have to say yes. But it was not the complete coming of the kingdom of God. I like the way a number of scholars talk about it. They talk about the already and not yet. The kingdom of God was inaugurated, was begun, but did not come in fullness. And it won't until Jesus comes back. But we have the same Holy Spirit and the same power available to us that they had at that time. So that's essentially what that can mean. Are you more confused than you were? I see at least a couple people chuckling and nodding. Hopefully you understand that a little bit. Some would see glimpses at least of the kingdom of God before they died. And remember, most of these people that were hanging around Jesus were probably about his age, mid-20s, mid-30s. And they lived probably 30 to 50 more years, right? So they saw a lot of amazing things happen. Now, I'm going to read and run through this next section pretty quickly because I want to make some points, and I've got so many minutes left because I know y'all got your watch set for the 11:30, don't you? Right, Eric? So let's look through here. What's going on here? I do want to just mention this word in case I don't make it clear enough. This is called the Transfiguration. Verse 2, Tyler. This is called the Transfiguration, but it really should be the Transformation. We don't talk about changing your figure. We talk about changing your form. We talk about morphing. The Greek is clear. Figure is not a terrible translation, but it doesn't get the impetus, the impact of what the Greek is trying to say. He changed forms. He didn't just glow, so to speak, although that's what it says, but he somehow was transformed in their midst, and we'll get there. So, verse 2, after about 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured, changed, transformed before them. His clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus, period. Let's stop right there. Let's go back. It's not clear what mountain they were on, but they were not far from Caesarea Philippi. And some have said Tabor, and some have said Mount Hermon. It's more likely the one, I think it's Mount Hermon, that's closer up there to Caesarea Philippi. It's also about 9,000 feet as opposed to just 1,000 feet high. And so it's likely he went up a pretty good mountain for a ways, and he spent some time with these men. Now, it's not that important what mountain he was on, is it? If it had been important, they'd put the name in here. So speculating isn't going to help us get the point, but it is kind of interesting to think about. Well, if I'm just up 1,000 feet, they might, you know, more people might have followed him. But he took three up there, and he went to this special place. And there was Elijah, and there was Moses. Now, who was Moses? Moses was the great lawgiver, was he not? He was the one who led the people out of Egypt, led them with God showing the way with the cloud and the pillar of fire, and led them right up to the edge of the promised land. And he gave them, God gave through him, let me make that clear, but Moses gave them the Ten Commandments, written by God with his finger on tablets of stone. So Moses was there, the great lawgiver. Elijah was there, the great prophet. The first great prophet, possibly the greatest of all prophets. Just read through the Bible and think of what all Elijah did in his ministry. And Elisha just wanted a little bit. Actually, he asked for a double portion. But if I could just have a little bit of your power, I'd be okay, Elijah said, essentially. And so he was up there with God, yes. But Elijah and Moses, the representatives of the law and the prophets, were there with him. Now just think about them for a minute. That's the whole of the Bible right there. You've got the law, you've got the prophets, you've got the new covenant, Jesus, right there. And little old Peter, James, and John are sitting over there just eyeballs bugging out. You can just imagine what's going on. And their eyeballs are bugging out. They don't even know what they're doing. And then Peter opens his mouth and speaks before he can get his foot out of it. Right? Hey, Rabbi, let's just stay here. It's good that we were here. Let's make three tents. One for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. And we'll just camp out up here on the mountaintop. How many have heard about being on the mountaintop, having a special experience with God, staying on the spiritual mountaintop? Go to camp with the youth. At least that's the way we used to be. You come home, that was a mountaintop experience, right? Many of us still like to go to the mountains because there's something special about being up in the mountains and feeling closer to God. I don't think it's the altitude. I just think it's the beauty of it and the grandeur of the mountains. And they were up there and they just wanted to stay on the mountain. Let us stay here. In verse 6, it said, for he didn't know what to say. Well, fancy that. That's not new to Peter, is it? Jesus, just a few verses, 7 days earlier, right? 6 days later, he came up. 7 days earlier, he said, Rabbi, you shouldn't die. You can't die. And Peter had to rebuke him and called him Satan. I mean, Jesus had to rebuke Peter. You meant what I knew, right? So they're up here on this mountain. Peter didn't know what to say, for they were terrified. I mean, you wouldn't know what to say either, would you? Here's your friend you've been walking with for who knows how long, months. Nothing like this ever happened. I mean, you've been called apart because you're the three. You're the inner circle. You've been called apart to go and spend some time alone with him. You're the one that he sends to do different things from time to time. Peter, James, and John were alone with him. What would you do? What would you say? I believe I'd be shaking in my sandals, right? Not in my boots. Shaking in my sandals and just, who knows? If I could get anything out, I'd probably blurb that out too. And then a cloud comes over them. And a voice out of the cloud said, this is my beloved son. Listen to verse 7. Listen to him. This is my beloved son. Now, if you happen to remember anything, this happened at the baptism, right? Came up out of the water, the Holy Spirit descended upon him. This is Matthew and Luke, it's not in Mark, all this stuff. Holy Spirit came upon him, and a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved son. Listen to him. We don't get that kind of a statement in Mark until we get to the cross, or until we get here and then again to the cross. So we're halfway through. And we've got the confession of Jesus as the Messiah. And now we've got God's word, but not man's confession of him as the Son. So God came down, the cloud shone around. You know what happens with the cloud. I just talked about Moses, right? The cloud always leads the people of God. And then all of a sudden, next verse. They looked around and no longer saw anyone with them, but only Jesus. It was a special manifestation. It was a special time when Jesus, in his full glory, was showing was there in front of himself, was manifested there in front of himself, and he had Moses and Elijah, the law and the prophets standing there with him, and God's voice confirming that this is my son. Now, let me just pause for a minute. Why do you think Jesus had to go up there? Have you ever thought about that? As I was reading this and studying it and looking at some of the commentators, I began to realize that this was a little unusual. When Jesus went away to pray and be alone with the Father, he usually did it separately. But he went with these disciples, not sure all that's involved in that. But think about it. If you look to Luke, in chapter 9, these same things are happening. Luke chapter 9, I believe the transfiguration actually happens about verse 28. And anyway, if you look in Luke, you see the same types of things happening. And then at the end of chapter 9, it says very clearly that Jesus set his face to go to Jerusalem. He knew what was coming. Peter, James, and John probably thought, hey, this gig is going on for a little while. Right? This is getting better and better all along the way. Now we've seen the glory of God show up. What's going to happen next? Can you just imagine what's racing through their minds? And yet Jesus needed to be up there, needed to be assured, yes, you're doing it right. Keep on going. All of the law and the prophets have pointed to this very moment in history. You are the one. You are the Son of God. You are the one that needs to go all the way to the cross. And we see that tied together a little more fully in Luke chapter 9 when it says that toward the end of that chapter. But Jesus, maybe the human side was needing a little word from God. And he got it. In verse 9, let's go on. As they were coming down the mountain, he charged them not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had raised from the dead. Now listen, they're already confused. Can you imagine what they were thinking now? Son of God's going to rise from the dead. Wait a minute. This doesn't happen. People rising from the dead. And yet Jesus had already raised at least two people from the dead by this time in the Gospels. But the Son of Man had done all these things. Now, do you remember I talked about something called the Messianic Secret in my first several sermons? I talked about Messianic Secret. Remember the demons? Anytime he cast out the demons, what did he say? Shh. Heal the sick. Shh. Raise the paralyzed, shh, be quiet, don't tell anybody. The lepers, don't go into town, go to the priest. Every time that he healed somebody, every time that he exorcised a demon, every time he did pretty much anything in Mark to this point, he's going, shh, don't tell anybody. Why do you think that is? My understanding of that device, that literary device, is that people didn't understand who Jesus was. Peter and James and John are the same thing, aren't they? Do you feel that way sometimes? Who is this Jesus? What are you asking of me? When I read the Word of God and I see what Jesus has done and what He said, I'm going, oh my goodness, I don't understand. But coming down, He said, y'all be quiet, don't say anything about it. So they, verse 10, they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what the rising from the dead might mean. Verse 11, and they asked him, out of their confusion, why did the scribes say that first Elijah must come? Wonder where that question came from. What do you think? Huh? They just saw him. Right? They just saw Elijah. Wait a minute, isn't he supposed to come? Isn't he supposed to lead the way? And of course, they were thinking of that Elijah, and Jesus said, well, Elijah does come first. The next verse, chapter 12, Elijah does come first to restore all things. How is it written of the Son of Man that he should suffer many things and be treated with contempt? Just kind of, again, emphasizing what's coming up. Verse 13, But I tell you, Elijah has come, and they did to him what they pleased, as it is written of him. Who's Elijah? Does anybody know? Of course. John the Baptist. John the Baptist came in the image and likeness of, in ministry of Elijah. That's kind of interesting thought if you've never thought about it. Well, let's go on. We got to do this quickly. So I want to get through this section. I'm just going to read several sections. The setting is they're coming down the mountain. Verse 14, they came to the disciples. They saw a great crowd around them, scribes arguing with them. And immediately all the crowd, when they saw him, they were greatly amazed and ran up to him. Some scholars have thought, well, maybe he's still got a little glow about him. I've always thought that. Some of the scholars say, no, it couldn't have been that, because that would have been too obvious. Why would he tell them to hush? Shh. And yet he's still glowing like Moses. Remember when Moses met with God? He glowed with the Shekinah glory. They ran up and greeted him, and he asked them, what are you guys arguing about? Someone from the crowd answered him, teacher, I brought my son to you, for he has a spirit that makes him mute. It's not just mute, but watch. Verse 18, whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth, and he becomes rigid. So I asked your disciples to cast it out, and they couldn't. Sounds like an epileptic fit. That's what we would say. Some would call that moonstruck. That's the old way of saying it. Y'all ever heard that? Anybody ever heard moonstruck for epilepsy? But he was he was having problems, and they thought it was a demon. I asked your disciples at the end of chapter verse 18, I asked your disciples to cast it out, and they weren't able. Jesus just had the mountaintop experience, and then what happens? Oh, my goodness. Can you just, I mean, he's communicating with himself, right? God the Son and God the Father. Who are these guys you gave me? Right? I mean, you got to look at the humor at some of this, because if we don't, it just gets, you just read through it and you go, what's going on here? I don't understand. But here's these nine, because there were 12, right? And three had gone up the mountain with him. There are nine guys down there, and they couldn't even cast out one little demon. And Jesus had already sent them out and done their thing one time, and they come back. And and he's just like, oh, bother. Or, oh, Father, right? Oh, bother, what's going on here? So let's read. Oh, faithless generation, how long have I got to stay with you? I'm sorry, Frank White, paraphrasing it a little bit. How long am I to bear with you? Bring him over here. So they brought the boy to him, and when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell to the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. Just bring back images of previous demons that we've talked about before. Go ahead, keep going, Tyler. I'm just making a little comment here. The demon sees Jesus. He doesn't speak. He just does his thing and convulses the boy. Verse 21. Jesus is calm. I love this. And he asked the father, hey, how long has this been going on? Oh, the father said, from childhood. And it often casts him into the fire and into the water, trying to destroy him. But if you can do anything, please have compassion on us and help us. Can you imagine? Stay on that one for a minute. Can you imagine? He's had nine disciples praying over him. The demons just probably laughing at him. The guys may be rolling on the ground from time to time. And they can't do anything, and the crowd's just gathering. And the scribes, if you saw it back earlier, they were down there in verse 14, the great crowd and the scribes, and they were all, see, I told you, you couldn't do it. You can't do anything. Y'all are going after the wrong spirit. These scribes are probably saying, that's the gist of what I think. And Jesus said to the man, if you can, are you serious? You don't think I can? You're asking me, if you can do anything, please help me. Jesus goes on and says, all things are possible for those who believe. all things are possible. And immediately the father of the child cried out, oh, I do believe. Help my unbelief or my lack of belief. The form of that word, the contrast between my faith and my lack of faith, it's just one letter. It's an A. Have you ever heard the term symmetric? Right? Two things look alike on both sides, right? And what is asymmetric? Means this side is different from this side, right? So that's what this guy is saying. He said, I have faith, but it's not the same kind of faith I guess I need. So you ever feel that way? I sure do. I need more faith. I pray that from time to time. God, help me to have faith, particularly when I'm praying for someone who needs healing. God, help me to have faith. I don't doubt your ability, but I'm not sure about my faith. And Jesus goes on. He says, immediately the father said, I believe, help my unbelief. And Jesus saw the crowd came running together. He rebuked the unclean spirit, saying, you mute and deaf spirit, I command you come out of him and never enter him again. That's an interesting phrase, because there's one place in the scripture that talks about one bad spirit going out and the guy didn't do anything to refill himself and he got seven worse spirits in himself and came back. Y'all remember that story at all? If not, you need to go look it up. So he said, don't ever go back to him again. And after crying out and convulsing the boy terribly, it came out of him, and the boy looked like a corpse, so that most were saying he was dead. Now the situation's worse than before. What do you think the father's faith is feeling like right now? You ever done that? You ever prayed for someone to get better and they get worse? Does that mean God's not still in control? No. God is still in control. He just answers things differently. And so Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he arose. When he entered the house, his disciples asked him privately, why could we not cast it out? And he said, this kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer. And some manuscripts include and fasting. Okay? Some add and fasting. Now, there are multiple times of healing when Jesus reached out and grabbed him by the hand and brought him up and the healing was completed. How about Peter's mother-in-law? Remember? She was sick. He said a word, took her by the hand, stood her up. Jairus' daughter, chapter 5. She had died, 12 years old. She had died. He spoke a word, took her by the hand, said, hey, give her something to eat. And that happened even in the book of Acts when Dorcas was healed, took her by the hand, raised her up. The significance here to me is not quite as clear in Mark, but very clear in Luke, that Jesus was heading to Jerusalem and he needed this time with God. It's probable Jesus needed that extra amount of encouragement that he could only have by spending time with God, but he didn't want to do it alone this time. Remember when he needed that extra time with God at the end of his life? He went into the Garden of Gethsemane, and he took Peter, James, and John to be nearby, and he went to be close to his Father. Well, he knows what's coming, and while he's not in Jerusalem, he needed to be close with his Father. That's the first thing I want you to see today. While he was there, his time with his father included seeing the great lawgiver Moses and the great prophet Elijah. Two aspects that paved the way, two people that paved the way for his coming as the Messiah. Tying the whole Old Testament together with the New Testament. And he needed some extra time in prayer. He needed some extra time in prayer. When he descended down from the mountain, he was ready to face the mob and to go to the cross. First, he had to heal the boy with epilepsy, but he could only do it because he had spent the extra time with his father. and, as some manuscripts say, and fasting. And then he was ready to go on to Jerusalem. So what can we learn from this story in order to have a transformative year ahead? I believe we need to follow Jesus' example. We need to spend more time with God. As I was sitting in Sunday school class this morning in the open door class, and I was reading through that end of that book, and I was going, oh, y'all are going to hear the same thing in the sermon today. We need to spend more time with God. In general, that comes from reading His Word, praying, being silent, and in solitude before God. Almost from the beginning of my time here, particularly after COVID cleared, I've been investing time with some men, trying to encourage them to spend more time in the Word of God and to pray. I've been blessed to spend time with Eric and another, with Jackie and Arthur, who now have two men that they're pouring into and helping encourage in their Bible reading. I'm meeting with two other men right now, and I've invited two other guys already to go find another person. I want to open myself up for a couple of more of you. If you would like to meet with me and read Scripture more this year, you need the accountability. I will gladly try to make it fit my schedule. And we can do that in groups of three. Two others, you and a friend, and me. I know one women's group that's doing it. How's that working out? I see a smile. Y'all are sitting beside me saying, where's the other one? Where's the third one? So it's great. Reading the Scripture, spending time together, encouraging one another in the things we should do. Second thing that Jesus did while he was on the mountain spending time with his Father was he spent time in prayer. We need to spend more time in prayer. Before heading to Indonesia, I listened to a sermon. I think it was Charles Swindoll, but that's been 100 years ago. So I can't remember exactly, but I was listening to a sermon on prayer. He was talking about all kinds of ways to help prayer, and he came to an illustration. He said, all the great preachers and evangelists of old time have always said they've never spent enough time in prayer. They wish they had more time in prayer. We're talking about the likes of Charles Spurgeon and John and Charles Wesley and Billy Graham, modern era, a little more modern. And then fasting. It doesn't have it in the main manuscripts and in translation here, but I believe fasting is something that we need to consider more seriously. And I'm not talking about just putting down your phone for a day and fasting from technology for a day. That's helpful because you get a little quieter with God. I'm talking about real sacrifice. At least a meal. Some of you are diabetic or hypoglycemic. You can't have that fluctuation, but you can possibly skip something. Consider fasting this year. I plan to begin fasting regularly again this year. I've done it in the past repeatedly. It will always give me more time to pray, to be silent and still before God. As the question in the Sunday school literature said this morning, what are some things you need to do in this new year to overcome falling short of the mark of God's desires? And I suggest those things. If you truly want a transformative year ahead, I invite you to join me in doing what Jesus did. Spending time with the Father. Spending time. We have to spend time in the Word. He was the Word, right? Jesus was the living Word who took on flesh. But we need to spend time in the Word. We need to invest more time in prayer. And I encourage you to consider investing some time in fasting today. If you want a truly transformative year, there you have it. Spend time with God. Nothing any easier than that. Nothing any harder than that, too. Just be with Him. Can you do that? Let's take a page out of Jesus' playbook and spend time with God. Let's pray. Father in heaven, like I just said from Chuck Swindoll's sermon, the great preachers and evangelists felt that they didn't have enough time in prayer with you. And so, God, I pray that as we head into the new year, we will realize that the only way we can know what you want and know how to live out our faith is to spend time with you. May we go to the mountaintop and invest that time. And may we take others with us as Jesus did on this occasion. In your name we pray. Amen. As we sing this song, hey, it's New Year's Eve. I'm not asking you to make a resolution because that'll probably make it till the 6th or 7th. Maybe the 1st of February. But I am asking you to consider committing yourself to the Lord anew. You're welcome to come and pray by yourself. Pray with me. If you're interested in joining one of those triads with me, come to me and talk to me after the service. Let us stand and sing together. Thank you so much for being here today. I hope you have a great afternoon. Be safe today. It gets a little crazy on New Year's Eve sometimes, doesn't it? So if you get out and have fun, I know there's a youth party this evening. Y'all have fun. Enjoy it, but be careful. And we'll see you next year. All right? Let's bow in a word of prayer as we go. Father, you have indeed blessed us this year in many, many ways. Help us to be a blessing to those around us as we head into 2024. It's in your name we pray. Amen.